could imagine that we never could find so much hope at a cross made of wood, but it's found in abundance there at the cross of Christ. Who could conceive that we'd find such peace there at the foot of a torturous tree, but it's found in abundance there at the cross of Christ. In a place you would think you'd be finding despair, the signs of God's grace are found everywhere, 'cause at the cross of Christ we were redeemed. At the cross of Christ we were set free by the blood he had shed. Such love up on that hill where the condemned were hung, but it's found in abundance there at the cross of Christ. For more than who would have dreamed that great joy would fill a place where his innocent blood had been spilled, but it's found in abundance there at the cross of Christ. In a place once renowned for sorrow and pain, you can now hear God's praise in a joyous refrain, 'cause at the cross of Christ we were redeemed. At the cross of Christ we were set free by the blood he had shed.
Cascading stream flowing through fields of green, and the mountains
mountains that rise up before them. You know, so many ways, the beauty of a life has shined on my face. And yet I know of one thing that surpasses by far the beauty I've seen, the most beautiful thing I know is the cross with the Savior who died for us all, and the blood that flowed from his hands and feet, and the wounds he bore so that we be redeemed. This is the most beautiful thing. I've stood on the edge of a grand precipice, overwhelmed by the span of creation. Then sat teary-eyed while the sun paints the sky as it settles beyond the horizon. And I'm still so amazed at the beauty that life has shined on. Who died for us all, and the blood that flowed from his hands and feet, and the wounds he bore so that we'd be redeemed. This is the most beautiful thing. So amazed at the beauty that life has shined on my face. But one thing stands alone, unrivaled and incomparable, the most beautiful thing I know is the cross with the Savior who died for us all, and the blood that flowed from his hands and feet, and the wounds he bore so that we'd be redeemed. This is the most beautiful thing. This is the most beautiful thing.
Let us arise, please. And again, we'd like to have you follow along in your pamphlet that you have. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Sing to the Lord, you saints of His, praise His holy name.
I will sing and make music.
I will praise you, O Lord, among the nations. I will sing of you among the peoples.
For great is your love, reaching to the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches to the skies.
Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth.
All the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of our God.
Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Burst into jubilant song with music.
Make music to the Lord with the harp and the sound of singing. Shout for joy before the Lord, the King.
of his hands.
Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise him in the highest above.
I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made.
Your works are wonderful. I know that full well.
Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. You may be seated as we now continue with the singing of hymn 256, How Great Thou Art. Love and to serve him as his dear children, but we have disobeyed him. And we deserve only his wrath and punishment. And therefore, let us confess our sins to him and plead for his mercy. Merciful Father in heaven, I am altogether sinful from birth. In countless ways I have sinned against you and do not deserve to be called your child. But trusting in Jesus, my Savior, I pray, have mercy on me according to your unfailing love. Cleanse me from my sin and take away my guilt. God, our Heavenly Father, has forgiven us for all of our sins by the perfect life and innocent sufferings, death, and resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He has removed our guilt forever, and we are now his own dear children. May God give us all the strength to live according to his will. Amen. You may be seated. Stephen's daughter, Marissa, now sing Saved.
And this song called Saved, it celebrates the fact that Jesus has rescued us from our sin. He plucked us out of that sea of sin and depravity and now holds us safe and warm in the arms of his mercy for all eternity. And he saved us. And we can sing hallelujah. Hallelujah, we are saved.
Weary, worn, and tattered, tossed about and battered, like a boat out on the raging sea. Gone adrift and helpless, broken down in distress, then the Lord stretched out his arms to me. Now I'll be safe and warm from the storm, kept from harm in his arms. When the tempest hits me, sheltered by his mercy, safe and warm from the storm. Just when I flounder, quickly go and under, Jesus pulled me from the crashing waves. Now that I have been kept, sinking to a great depth, I rejoice and praise his holy name. 'Cause I've been saved, saved and born from the storm, kept from harm in his arms. When the tempest hits me, sheltered by his mercy, safe and warm from the storm. And I sing hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Safe and warm from the storm.
Ephesians chapter 1 verse 4, how God's love chose each and every one of us here today. It says here, for he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. Long before God ever created the heavens and the earth, he had a plan concerning each and every one of you here today. And that is, he would bring us home to heaven. He would call us his children and choose us to be holy and blameless. Now, it wasn't that we were holy and blameless to begin with, no. And then for that reason, God took a liking to us and chose us. I mean, that's generally how you pick out your friends, right? You know, you find somebody who's of the same wavelength, same interests, same values, morals, same interests, things like that. Well, that wasn't our case. No, far from it. He chose us when we had no righteousness to offer. I mean, we were dead, enemies of God, blind in that we didn't know the way to heaven. We were dead in that we couldn't do anything to make up for our sins. Literally impossible. And we were enemies. We hated God. We despised God because we were led astray by Satan into thinking that it was God who wanted to send us to hell. And so we needed help. That Paul tells us, God chose us not because we were holy and blameless, but he chose us to be holy and blameless. He chose us sinners that we are in order to make us righteous in Christ. He didn't want to see any of us perish in hell. He knew that there was no other way for us to save ourselves, and so he sent his son Jesus. And when Jesus came into this world and lived that perfect, sinless life for us and covered us with his holiness, he was thinking of each and every one of you. And when he went to the cross and had those nails driven into his hands and his feet, he was thinking of all of us at that time. And when he said, it is finished, there on the cross, he again was thinking of us as he set us free from our sins, from death and hell, and provided us with forgiveness, life, and salvation. And when he rose again from the dead, we were also on his mind, as he knew that we, whom he had chosen through faith in Jesus, in accordance with his pleasure and will, would someday be with him in heaven. And so listen now as we hear about how he chose us in the song, You Thought of Me.
Did you
really think of me. When you were betrayed by a kiss and felt the nails go through your wrist, when you suffered agony, did you really think of me?
Walk away and given. But when it came to our Lord Jesus, he had deep, deep love for all of you. You, as I said, were very, very precious in his sight. You were more important than anything else in all this world. And because of that tremendous love, which we never can comprehend until at least we get to heaven, he never, ever budged an inch. He never flinched, but he stuck to all that pain, guilt, and shame that we should have endured and been left with. We who are loveless and unlovable. But again, in God's eyes, as I said, we were very precious, and Jesus demonstrated for us what true love is all about. A love in which he thought more of us than himself. And so when we see him there on the cross, we are reminded first of how serious God was about our sins. But we also see at the same time is how God was serious about adopting us into his family and taking us home to heaven. Listen now, as we hear, you never did.
I never fully understood why you agreed to save us when you knew the price you had to pay was pain beyond endurance. I know if I were in your shoes, I wouldn't hesitate to leave this world of fools. Thank you.
you never did.
From Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13, love found. And you were also included in Christ when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. Having believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit. Now that God has chosen us and made it possible for us to be members of his family through the saving work of Christ, he now places a seal on us. It's like a contract. And that is the Holy Spirit. You know, it's when Paul was talking to the Gentile Ephesian believers, he put them right alongside the Jewish believers. And we have all, Gentiles and Jews alike, who have been brought to faith in Jesus, are all one body. Jesus is the head, we are the body. And when we say that we believe in Jesus as our Lord and Savior, that through him we have the forgiveness of sins, life, and salvation, it's all because we have been marked with the seal, the promised Holy Spirit. For Paul says, no one can say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. So for you to be able to come here today, for you to want to worship the Lord, for you to confess your sins and to know that Jesus loves and forgives you, to be able to sing our praises to him from the heart and ring out our sweet alleluias, it's all because you have been marked with the seal, the Holy Spirit. And it all began, I think for most of you, if not all of you, there at the baptismal font. It was there where the Holy Spirit led your parents to have you baptized. And the moment that you were baptized, we see how the Holy Spirit created faith in our hearts so that we could believe in him. It was then that all of our sins were washed away. We were adopted into his family and given the promise that we would be with him in heaven forever and ever. And we got that promise every day. That, you know, when you get up in the morning, you've got your baptism. That's that contract, that seal, that boy, I am a child of God. And no matter how badly life goes, you know, Paul once said, you know, all the suffering in the world, that doesn't compare to what we've got to look forward to. You know, again, this is only our temporary life here on this earth. That's it. Our real life is awaiting us in heaven. Sort of like when you're going on vacation and you made reservations at a motel. Well, God, through the Holy Spirit, made reservations for us. And he's got a beautiful room, better than any motel room you could ever go to, for you there in heaven. And yes, it is that Holy Spirit who continues to work through the gospel and through the sacraments to reveal to you God's amazing grace, bringing us that peace, that comfort of how Jesus has redeemed us from all of our sins and given us the sure hope of, and certainty that we are God's forgiven children. Even though others may not forgive us, we are forgiven in God's sight. And we'll spend an eternity with him in heaven. A message that we need to share with our children and with everyone in this world. Steve and Marissa will now sing a sweet, sweet song.
There's a sun rising up through the air, drowning out the bitter cry of despair. Bellowing over the voice of fear is the sound of hope, resonating out with the hurting arm. It echoes through the walls of a broken heart, penetrating down through the deepest scar. It's the sound of hope. It's the sweet, sweet sound of a sinner's praise when their wayward soul is found, as they sing a song of amazing grace. All their voices arise in a sweet, sweet sound. Times of cathedral halls, reverberating out through the chapel walls, ringing in the streets like a distant call. It's the sound of hope. It beckons to the hearts of the world in need, and telling them the story of the redeemed, proclaiming that Jesus has set them free. It's the sound of hope. The sweet, sweet sound of a sinner's praise when their wayward soul is found, as they sing a song of amazing grace. All their voices arise in a sweet, sweet sound. A sweet, sweet sound. It's a sweet sound when we sing our praises.
Instead of being bitter and angry with our neighbor or using loud and insulting speech. The Lord wants us to be considerate, thoughtful, caring, loving, forgiving. You know, Paul tries to help the Ephesians as well as us in this important area of sanctification by using a picture. You know, we've all been intrigued by the sight of a toddler trying to imitate his body. Maybe it's pounding a hammer. Maybe it's throwing a ball, raking leaves. Maybe it's playing a guitar. You know? Or then again, maybe it's a daughter taking care of her little doll like mom takes care of a baby. Or pretending to be making a meal. Or as I heard today, pretending to be me and having church service. And, you know, and the point that Paul is getting across here is that he's suggesting that we all follow our Lord's example. Be imitators of him. Do as the Father has done for all of you. You know, he urges us, as I said, to be forgiving towards one another, just as God has forgiven each and every one of you. Remember the story of the lost son? We just talked about that a couple weeks ago. And the son realized that he really messed up in life big time, and he was really sorry. He was going home, and he was starving to death, and he was just hoping that possibly his father might let him in as a servant, take him back as a servant. But yet what happened? When the son got close to home, the father saw him from a distance, and what did he do? He ran out to him, and he hugged him, and he welcomed him home, and he forgave him before the son could even get the words out that, "I'm sorry, Dad, I messed up." You know, and Peter, you know, Peter one day asked Jesus, he said, "Well, how many times are we supposed to forgive people? 70 times, 7 times, you know, 490 times a day?" And Jesus said, "Indefinitely." And he also urges us as redeemed children of God to live a life of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant, sweet-smelling sacrifice to God. You know, we need to keep in mind that one time we were all broken and damaged goods. We were all destined for hell. But God changed that for us. Not only through Jesus, but the moment that we were brought to faith by his grace. And you and I have been restored and renewed. We're no better than anybody else. We have the right to go around and talk about people behind their back and about their sins and terrible things that they've done. He never did that to us. And because of that, he's given us loveless sinners new hearts and a new mind. It is God who creates in you a new man. And because of that, through word and sacrament, and that new man, he gives you the power to imitate him by being forgiving and kind to others from the heart and by reaching out and showing forth a life of love and thoughtfulness and care and concern. Yes, because of him, we can reach out to all kinds of people and we can make a difference in this world. Now, I'm not saying you're going to go out and convert everybody in the world. No, I'm not saying that. Person by person by person. And we pray that as God has blessed us and brought us into his family and forgiven us of all of our sins and continues to help and provide and protect us each and every day, that he help all of us to be a wonderful reflection of his love towards others. And you know, you can love. You've got that power from the Holy Spirit, because Jesus first loved us. And so let us go, motivated by God's love, as we hear in our next song, "Make a Difference." And as Steve sings that, we will receive our gifts of love at the same time for our good and loving, gracious, and merciful God. Grant that in heaven we may all partake together of your divine pleasure and feast at the table of your goodness forevermore. And in whose name we also pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And then he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me." And the peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. You may be seated.
I'm home.
guilty man. How could I be called by the great I am? With my many failings, you still call my name to follow and serve you in a new life of grace. So Lord, I will follow and take up my cross and keep my eyes on you so I'll never get lost. But I'll need your strength, Lord, when the road gets too hard. 'Cause I'm only human and you are God. Of a broken soul, through eyes of mercy, you can see me as whole. Lord, I will follow and take up my cross and keep my eyes on you so I'll never get lost. But I'll need your strength, Lord, when the road I'm only human, and you are God.
in leading our service with this prayer together. Almighty God, I am humbled and amazed that you have loved me so much that you chose me from eternity, sent your Son to pay the price for my sins, and found me while I was lost and a wayward sinner. Help me now to live a life of gratitude for all that you have done for me. Give me a caring heart to love and seek the lost and share my hope of salvation with those who have no hope. Make me faithful in my daily life so that all I say and do may glorify you. Amen. Brothers and sisters, go in peace and live in harmony with one another and serve the Lord with gladness. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. You may be seated as we're going to conclude with our final song. And that is Jesus Loves Me.
Yes, and we love to close this song service with Jesus Loves Me, because the song service expresses or explores God's love and reminds us of how he chose us from eternity, how he sent his Son to die for us, how he found us though we were lost and wayward sinners, and how we return that love out of thanksgiving for what he's done for us. And so what better way to celebrate that love than with a well-known and beloved children's song called Jesus Loves Me. And the way we're going to do this is Ellie, she is my four-year-old daughter, she's going to start us off and sing the first verse and the chorus. And by the way, the words are printed on, I believe it's the last sheet in the service folder. Ellie's going to start us off singing the first verse and the chorus, and then we're going to start over, and I invite everyone to join in. And yes, I do know it is a children's song, but we are all children of God, so we can all join in and celebrate that love with this song. And Elijah, he is my 10-year-old son. He's going to start us off, or he's going to do the sign language throughout the song, so keep an eye on him. And one other note, after the third verse, there is an original part that I wrote. You don't have to try and sing that. And I'll let you know when we come to that. But everything else sings the way we all know and love, Jesus Loves Me. All right, Ellie, go ahead and start us off.
Jesus loves me, yes, I know. For the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong. They are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so.
All right.
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me, yes, Jesus loves me, yes, Jesus loves me. Tells me so. Jesus loves me, this I know, as he loved so long ago, taking children on his knee, saying, let them come to me.